I think we're going to have a really interesting session here. Title of the session is A Growth Engine That Took Me From a Few Zeros to Millions in a Few Years. And so we're really lucky to have three scientists who were involved somewhere. Two are founders, and one came in soon after the company was formed and kind of witnessed the fast translation of a great scientific idea into a quite large market opportunity. So my name's Will Cardwell. I'll be the host and moderator. And I think the idea here will be that we'll start with Reta, who will give a short talk about her the rise of her company. And I'll introduce each speaker before they give their presentation. So we'll start with Dr. Reta Kivila. She's from Finland and has a PhD in food science, an innovator in oat-based vegetable protein product. I love this case because actually I was leading some classes at Helsinki University, and I had the pleasure to meet her colleague, a young Chinese scientist, as they were getting started. And it was really interesting to see how they kind of took two different substances, oats and fava beans, and united them into something really interesting. So, Reta, why don't you come and tell the story of Golden Green? Thanks.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. So now we talk for a while about Golden Green. That is a Finnish startup, only 3 years old. So it looks quite a longer time we have been existing, but it has been only 3 years. I'm going to go to this renewable food that has been inspiring us, because there is lots of talk about renewable energy. We are putting billions and millions to the research and companies of finding out how to make renewable energy. But food is one of the biggest thing if thinking about the environmental issues. So why not to think the food also as renewable thing? And this is the story of pulled oats. So pulled oats is our first product that we have had. Yeah, if thinking about food, so all food should be renewable, but in the end of the day, only those that are growing in healthy ecosystems are renewable. And if we need to have this efficiency that is needed for feeding all the animals, and if you're just using all those modern and really destroying farming habits that we are now having, then we are going to a wrong direction. So we were two girls or ladies, and we thought that something needs to be done. And we thought that it can be us. We can only talk about just something should be done, but we just decided that actually we know something about food, and we are the one who can try to do something for that. So we were just wanting to think simple, just taking the ingredients that we love and make some real food for everyday life. And it's clear that food is the number first opportunity to fight the climate change. So it was quite clear that if we know about food, so why not to do something by ourselves? And our vision has been from the very beginning that we want to break the meat habit all over the world. So we didn't innovate only for Finland or only for Scandinavia, but we wanted to do a product that is suitable everywhere. So what is pulled oats? It's a tricky name because we wanted somehow to combine the world of meats, but also to say that this is actually made of oats and made of good ingredients. So it's something that needs to be tasty in every different dishes. It's healthy, sustainable, convenient, and affordable. So we started to hunt the perfect protein, and I think we managed to do it. So from the healthy side and the environmental side, but also how to use it. I think that we made the perfect protein. So we combined oats and beans. Oats, because oats is full of everything healthy, so it's one of the most healthiest cereals on top of the world, and it's growing really nicely in the northern countries, so that's why it's really dear for us living in Finland. And also beans, we need it because oat contains lots of health benefits, but it lacks some amino acids that we need for having a perfect protein. So we needed to have some beans that lacks some amino acids that are rich in oats. So in that way, we made a perfect match with oats and beans. And these our technologies, they are patented, and they are always from Nordic ingredients. We don't use any soy or wheat that are the most or the major crops. And we want to have always more protein in our products than chicken, than for example in chicken or beef. So not only the quality of the protein, but also the quantity is important for us. And what is also important is that we don't use any additives. So our ingredients are only those that we can find from our kitchen, and only those that are understandable. So there is only oats, beans, peas, oil, and spices. Yep, and as I said, so it's important that it's versatile so that everyone can use the product to their like everyday dishes, and we have those recipes and hints, lots of in the internet, so you can all go and see what you can make out of pulled oats. And there in the corner is one of our newest products, so they are oat balls. Also, the sustainable corner is very obvious, because we are using those ingredients that are usually used for animals. We are using them for humans, so we don't need this animal step at all. And also, we just counted that last year we were saving clean water 70 billion liters, so it's a quite huge amount. If it just, not every meal, but some of the meals we just change from meat to our products, so we can save just with one serving like 5 bath tubes of clean water. Then just a few words about our journey. Golden Green was founded 2015, and that was founded by early investors' money and also government money. So we got some few hundred thousand euros, and we could hire our first employee and make some research. So this was really like basic research what we made. We were trying just every kind of different methods and techniques to gain interesting textures out of our ingredients that we wanted to use. And our idea has been all the time to use like the traditional processes, but combine them in a new way, or use them a little bit like wrong way to gain new and interesting structures. Then 2016, there was a huge hype around us in Finland, so it was quite clear that we need to start a production. Just the retailers and the consumers, just everyone was just screaming to and wanting to have our product. So in May 2016, we were delivering our first pallets out of this brand new factory, and we ramped up our first process line about 2 months, so it was one of the most fastest ramp up, I think. And then we had three products. Nowadays we had like 14 products already, and we have all the retailers in Finland also exporting to Sweden and Norway, and having this big international food service companies. as clients. And 2017, we got a new owner, so 51% of us is owned by a big company in Finland, and that helped us a lot. So we were able to industrialize and go as fast as possible. Now we have two industrial size process lines, and also one other factory is built up in Sweden. Yeah, and this year, of course, we need to just expand our portfolio, expand the licensing that we are doing in different countries, and also globalize in different ways. Yes, that's it.
Okay, so we'll dig into some other the interesting aspects of the growth of the company in a minute. But next I'd like to introduce Dr. Imogen Wright from Hyrax Bio. She's a software developer, bioinformatician, who previously worked in software development at Amazon, actually. And is a senior software developer and team lead for a successful London-based big data startup, Skimlinks. She then completed her PhD in bioinformatics, during which she designed and implemented the Hyrax Biosciences novel, highly accurate mutation calling algorithm. So why don't you tell us a little bit about your journey?
Hi, everybody. I'm not going to stand there. So my name's Imogen. I'm the CTO of Hyrax Biosciences, and I'm just going to walk you through, the journey that my company's been on over the course of about the last half decade, and then maybe try and extract just a couple of general principles that I've been hearing in quite a lot of the talks over the last couple of days. So I'm going to first take you back to the year 2012, when I was a very naive PhD student in Simon Travers's lab at the University of the Western Cape. And more and more academic researchers were coming to us with roughly the same problem, which is this problem that you see above you. People wanted to do HIV drug resistance testing. They wanted to figure out what drugs HIV-positive people should be on, using a new, at the time, technology called next-generation DNA sequencing. But the problem that they were having was that the data coming off the machine was almost unanalyzable unless you had a couple of computer science degrees in about 6 months. And so they were coming to us as bioinformaticians with all this data saying, we don't know what to do with this. And we thought that was quite an interesting problem. Maybe we had a bit of an entrepreneurial mindset already, because when a lot of people come to you with the same problem, maybe it's your job to make the solution. And so we all got together, there were about four of us, and we spent about 18 months building a software package. We called it something much more embarrassing than Exotype in the beginning, but let's go with what we eventually ended up calling it. And we were quite proud of the software package, and people were starting to be interested in using it. And at this point, we went to the UWC Technology Transfer Office and said, look, we've made this piece of software. We think it's really cool. We think it could really help people with HIV, and we really want people to use it. But we're nice, so we're going to give it away for free. And the TTO was like, that's cute. How are you going to market that? How are you going to make it sustainable? How are you going to support it? What happens when one of you leaves the university? And basically took us very gently by the hand and walked us on a long journey from being essentially academics to ultimately deciding to start the company that would commercialize this ourselves. We took our software online. We're a cloud-based system now, and most of our small sort of research-based customers use us just through a normal web front end that you can go and log on to at exotype.com. They upload their next-generation sequencing data, and they get back drug resistance reports. With our bigger commercial customers, though, we now integrate directly with next-generation sequencing machines. We very helpfully got a wonderful grant from the Medical Research Council Strategic Health Innovation Partnership, got a lot of help from the TTO, and in the course of the last half decade, we've gone from being essentially an academic concern to partnering with one of the biggest pathology labs in the United States and partnering with one of the biggest medical device manufacturers in the world, mostly to deliver low-cost drug resistance testing in sub-Saharan Africa. So it's been a very, very exciting ride. While that commercialization adventure was happening, though, there was kind of a product adventure going on in the background. We started thinking about what we were making just a little bit differently. So instead of thinking that we were just an HIV drug resistance testing tool, we realized that what we'd built was quite a general genetic testing or drug resistance testing framework that we were plugging HIV rules into, taking in HIV data and getting out an HIV drug resistance report. And we looked around and thought, well, look, the main reason we started this company was to help people. Who else needs help? So we immediately started focusing on TB. And we realized if we plugged in TB rules, took in TB DNA sequence data, we'd get out a TB drug resistance report. And at this point, we also had a bit of a light bulb moment, which is that we're in the cloud and we're taking in enormous amounts of drug resistance data. Maybe we should try and aggregate some of this stuff and do something with it and potentially give it to a public health body. So that's kind of a process that we're involved in now, is trying to figure out what to do with this aggregated data that we're getting from around the world. It's very exciting that I think in just a few weeks, we'll actually be launching commercially our TB drug resistance product, and we have customers lined up for that already. So that's happening. And we're now setting our sights even higher into other pathogens, into antimicrobial resistance, that problem as a whole, and into other genetic testing that we could maybe help with. We've got a funding round open to do this next part of the adventure, and I couldn't be more excited for that. So I promised you some general principles. I'm going to talk to you about two potentially conflicting ideas that are actually very complementary, that I think have been really popular points that have come home across these sessions and have been really, really dear to our hearts. The first one is, contrary to what you might expect, I think that the entrepreneur's secret weapon is humility. I think saying you don't know all the time, every day, to each other. We said it to the technology transfer office in 2013. We say it to our customers all the time. Please tell us what to build, because we don't know. And I think that ability to let go of the idea that you have to be right all the time is also essential for the scientific integrity that you need to build a business like this. And then also, the potentially opposing principle that I think really grows from humility is courage. I've been so amazed by the courage of all the entrepreneurs that I've heard speak across the course of the last few sessions. It's been astonishing. And I think the courage to say that the world can be better, and the courage to say that we have something that people want to buy is something that comes from a place where you've already decided everything that you don't know, and you're willing to take a leap of faith anyway. I'm going to leave you with a quote by Wendell Berry. He's one of my favorite poets. He said that possibly the most, the best way to describe what the spirit of entrepreneurship is, which is, be joyful though you have considered all the facts. I'm going to leave you with that.
Wow, really interesting. Well, a lot of thoughts come to mind, and I hope everybody is collecting some possible questions for these guys once we get to the next stage. But that humility and courage, truly insightful, I think. That's also from the investor side what we look for sure. So our last panelist is Dr. Nick Walker. He's from a company called BioNext. But we'll talk about Nick. So Nick came in 2016 as an innovation scientist, developing technologies and services, as well as investigating possible new avenues in health and technology space. I'll let him tell a little bit more. One interesting thing from his background is he won the first global impact competition in South Africa and attended Singularity University for 10 weeks in their global solutions program. So be interested maybe to dig into some of that a little bit later. But why don't you tell a little bit about the company and about your journey?
Good morning, everyone. Firstly, thank you very much, Will, for the intro, and thanks for the organizers for inviting Next Biosciences. We're obviously very privileged to be on the stage with such wonderful founders. I feel like a little bit of an imposter on the stage because obviously these women are founders of their own company. I'm the head of business development for Next Biosciences. Unfortunately, our founder, Kim Hewlett, couldn't make it today. But hopefully I can do the story a bit of justice. I think it is quite an incredible story. Next Biosciences is what it's called now, and it's an umbrella of basically three different divisions. We've got a stem cell division, or biobanking, which includes semen and egg preservation. We've also got a genetics division, mainly focused on the preconception to post-birth. And then we've also got a therapeutics division, which is two biological products, which I'll discuss a little bit later. But it all goes back to the first division that I spoke, that I mentioned, which is NET cells, which is our umbilical cord blood and tissue storage service. That started in 2005, started in partnership with Kim, our founder, and the Netcare Group, which is it was the largest hospital group, I think it still might be actually, in South Africa. And an interesting sort of anecdote from that is that Kim gave away quite a big chunk of her company at the beginning to NetCells for the grand total of R1. She needed a strategic partner. Obviously, I think, as a lot of people in this room will understand, anything in sort of the health sciences product offering requires a bit of credibility, and the Netcare Group was able to bring that to her, and so started the business NetCells. Over the next 3 years, she helped build up the brand and the credibility. They were based at a hospital here in Pretoria, a Netcare hospital. And then in 2008, she purchased those shares back from Netcare, and moved our lab to Midrand, which is where we're currently situated. So ever since 2008, we've been situated in Midrand, and during that time, we've been building up sort of market share in the umbilical cord blood and tissue storage area, but we've also developed two products which form our therapeutics range. Those two products are, one of them is an amniotic membrane wound dressing, and the other one is an umbilical cord blood serum eye drop. They're both used mainly in ophthalmology applications, mainly after eye surgeries. The biological wound dressing is placed over the eye, as well as the application of the eye drops. Those were developed in-house, which we're obviously quite proud of. All that IP was held within our company, and the eye drops were actually a first in the world. No one had ever tried that, and we sort of pioneered that. Then at the beginning of 2016, which roughly sort of correlates with when I started, we acquired Genesis Genetics South Africa. Genesis Genetics is an international brand of genetic testing, mainly focused on the preconception to post-birth, so that's carrier screening, NIPT, non-invasive prenatal testing, as well as we've got some product offerings for the fertility clinics, which involve screening embryos to make sure which ones are the most genetically sound for implantation. From 2016 onwards, we've managed to build that company quite steadily. And one great thing about that is that we noticed that the same people that we were marketing the umbilical cord blood to is the same people that we'd be selling some of the genetic testing to, obviously the obstetricians and gynecologists. That was a very interesting and strategic move, I think, in our history, and it's something that we're focusing on now today. What other products can we offer to the same doctors and same patients? That's where we have our strengths. That's what we're good at. So how do we increase our increase our market there? Then the last sort of strategic area that we're working on is international business development. So we've currently got selling our products in Turkey, as well as Kenya and Zimbabwe. I think that's pretty much all about the company at this point, so I didn't have any slides. But yeah. I'm not sure how many of you guys know about Singularity University. It's a sort of a think tank, an entrepreneurial school. So can I just grab some water? Sorry about this. So it's an entrepreneurial sort of think tank. I spent 3 months there. It's based in Mountain View, which is sort of the epicenter of Silicon Valley. I was lucky enough to win a competition. It was actually 3 months into starting my work at this new job. I approached my boss and said, look, there's this amazing competition for this wonderful opportunity to go and spend 3 months in Silicon Valley, all paid. Do you mind if I enter this competition? And she sort of went, absolutely. I don't think she thought I'd win. I won, and I spent 3 months there, and it was fantastic. I came back with sort of a real appreciation for entrepreneurship. Obviously, the culture in Silicon Valley is so... it's so entrepreneurial and so driven that everything coming out of universities is towards products rather than research, which I find an incredible thing that we need to work towards here. Thanks.
Okay, good. Thank you. Thanks. Okay, so nice three kind of separate angles. And I'm going to, let's see if we can, I think these both work, but maybe you guys can share. So let me start this off. So a couple, a lot of things kind of came to mind, but so all of you are basically have been research scientists at some point, and now you're with companies that are really motivated to grow, create profits, things like this. So I want to ask maybe about what the you know, key kind of paradoxes maybe you've seen in that as you've kind of made this evolution. So maybe could I start with Rhett going, it's a tough question, I know, but dig in.
So the biggest paradox is?
Yes.
From a scientist to a
entrepreneur.
Yeah, I think, of course, there is happening growing every day, so it's like it comes piece by piece. But I do miss doing science a lot, so that's something, there is no time at the time. And that is the biggest paradox, that you are in the beginning very good in something, and then you make the innovation, but then when you start commercialize it, you don't have any time for innovation anymore. So that's only the leadership, and that's what we have been trying to learn a lot, how to lead the innovation so that the others can really make from like a how we see that it should be done.
So kind of setting a platform for these others to innovate, and you're now forced to kind of be an accelerator or a catalyst for the rest of the organization.
Yes, that's what I feel that I've been trying to create an organization that really can create similar innovations and can continue the work, because it's not possible anymore for the founders. But at the same time, I feel really lucky that I've been able to take the whole trip from the innovation to the really like a commercialized product, because we have to understand that the science and what we do in laboratory, it's totally different work what we do when we do the product. It's not a product that comes out from the laboratory. So the product development, it's a science itself. And then when going to the marketing and all concepting things, it's again a different story. So, and also we have been building the lines, like the innovative lines and the process development things. So I'm very happy I have been traveling this whole journey.
I wanted to add, what you gave me one statistic earlier, just to give people an idea of the scale of where you are right now. How much are you shipping of pulldoats per week?
It's about few tens thousands, yeah.
It's about 30,000.
About that, yeah.
From
30 to
units.
50, yes.
Okay, all right. So from being a nice theoretical product to delivering in that kind of volume, and then you have the challenge to take it to a next level.
Yeah, just having like a few grams of the product, it was quite, I wouldn't say easy, but it was quite obvious. I mean, we could make it. Then having few hundred grams, 400 kilos, it was totally different. And now like thousands kilos, so it's not the same process anymore.
Okay, great. Imogen, how about you?
I think I'm going to end up echoing quite a lot of what you said. I think the first interesting thing that I found as I moved out of straight research and into the business world was I realized that I'd had this notion that I guess scientists do research and then a miracle occurs and then the world gets better. And I hadn't really thought about that middle bit, and it turns out there's a lot in that middle bit. And now I'm kind of mostly involved in the middle bit, and that's been humbling and interesting. I'm in the lucky position where I still get to do science most days because drug resistance evolves so fast, so there's still, it's mostly kind of decision making as opposed to hands-on stuff now. But I think the danger with that is that I now have two jobs, and so that takes a lot of time. I think that my mindset has really changed over the course of the last few years in terms of I guess what value creation looks like and how do you add value, and realizing that getting a paper published and getting citations on that paper is wonderful way to realize a certain kind of value. And putting something else out into the world and having people pay for it is another way to get a signal that you're creating value. And yeah, we need both, and they're both really important. Yeah.
Okay. Nick, how about you?
Yeah, I think I'm going to echo pretty much everything again. I mean, you guys have, I think, nailed it. But one thing that I've found incredibly rewarding in the move was that with my research career, obviously, the purpose of what you're trying to do is publish something novel, and a lot of the times, the work that you do isn't really applicable to the real world just yet. And it's that actual realization that something that you're doing in, for instance, the business world is helping someone. We have a couple of products that increase the rates of pregnancies with IVF treatments, and that's incredibly rewarding when you know that something that you're doing, a service that you're performing, is actually making a meaningful difference in someone's life. So I think that in terms of reward, there's a big difference between selling something or providing a service than there is to do sort of observational research.
Interesting. Well, let me do one more round here, because the other thing that came to mind was there's a saying mostly in the software world, but I've always wondered how this translates into kind of more life science related or you know, places where, you know, it's not only code, but there's other elements involved, and that's what. You know, basic principle of lean startup is if you're not ashamed of your first product, you've probably waited too late to introduce it. And I'm wondering if that spurs any thoughts or ideas from. Well, you're holding the mic first, so Imogen, can you tell about that very first product that you came out with, maybe, and was it fully developed or was it still a little bit scary?
So in I think that the difference between, and we wrestled with this a lot, the kind of principles of starting a social media company and the principles of starting a biotech company cannot be exactly the same.
Thank God.
So there are, we kind of have two magisteria within the company, and I think in essentials, we can't be ashamed. We have to be able to stand over the science that we do 10 times beyond where we would think we're okay. And I think that's, so we have to divide that then from bugs in our user interface, which we have to occasionally just let go of. And I think it's been a really important process and journey that we've done quite explicitly, is dividing that line and saying where do we demand 100% and where do we let go. So yes, I was ashamed of our first product, but I was mostly ashamed because I think the delete button on Jobs didn't work. I wasn't ashamed because we were going to misdiagnose somebody.
Yes.
But I think that's the distinction.
Well, there's that joy that the product's out there now, and then that realization that actually it's not quite there. How about you, Rata?
Yes, of course, shame is included in this. Things, but we have been thinking ourselves as a lean startup all the time. So if we just have something we want to test, then we want to grab it as a product so that the consumer will understand. But when we are talking about food, there is the food safety laws and so on. So of course we need to be professionals what we are doing. But we had in the laboratory quite soon like 5 different products. And then we just invited our friends and fools, and they were saying their opinions about the products, and this pulled oats was the first one that everyone understood. So quite quickly, we just made make sure that they were safe, and they were real products, and we packed them, and we went to the supermarkets to test. And there the story starts. But the shame, I think, it's more about the concept. So we really didn't know how to tell about our product. So we were we have this oat thing, this oat something, and we didn't want to mention meat because we just do not want to be fake meat, and it was really tough. So what is this? It's you can make food out of it. So that was what we were struggling just before we were going to the supermarket where we were just wanting to have the tests. We were just talking with Maya, what do we say, and then we just here, there, we just thought that, hey, it needs to be pulled oats. There's a little bit meat, there's a little bit oats. And then it kind of like started to open what it really is. Yeah.
Interesting. Hey, well, I want to add one, so, or ask one more thing and hold something you said yesterday against you, that which I found really interesting. So you said that actually one of the challenges is that for people to give you real feedback, right? You were saying that you kind of felt that people were being nice to you because you were a couple ladies presenting a new product. And
yeah,
so
maybe
address that a little.
Already before the hype, because that has been huge in the small country, there is not happening so much. So if something is happening, just every papers are writing about it. But already before that, when we were having like really nice consumer studies and asking from different consumer groups, but only like response, what, where to buy this, where do I get this? And this was the first question, like the whole first year, like many times per day, where can I buy this? And then now when we have tried to test, like after this, our reputation that we have, yeah, it is a problem. No one criticizes the product. No one says that this doesn't taste good, or the texture is not good, but they are just saying that, hey, you guys know how to do things, that I believe on you. Yeah.
And I found that so interesting, and it gets a little bit also to Imogen's point about you actually, in a way, as scientists, you want criticism. Your whole life is, you know, you're always having opponents. Mm. And so you'd kind of like to get that kind of negative feedback in a way. And that's one thing I think all entrepreneurs need to realize, is it's actually a big success when somebody tells you something's wrong with the product, because then you can actually really go out and do something with it. So that's in a paradox sense, that's, you know, you're going out and testing and hoping you get some negative feedback, because if everybody says it's perfect, then something's wrong, basically.
Yeah, it's definitely, as you say, yeah.
Good.
It's like a big black hole. You have nothing there. Yeah.
Yes. So Nick, what is what can you bring to this?
Our company does a lot less sort of direct research and development, so I've got probably a little bit less to add to this. But what we do is we do quite a lot of distribution of tests, and that requires having a kit and marketing, etc. And it often takes a hell of a long time to get this going. And I remember at one point we were agonizing over the font of something, and our CEO came to us and said, don't ever let perfect get in the way of good enough. So
yeah,
we use that from then on.
Yeah, I think that's something that investors and other stakeholders, if there's anything that frustrates about scientific entrepreneurs, it's got to be perfect. So think about that as you go forward. So how about from the audience, some questions for the panel? Yes, please. Here comes the microphone.
All right. Good morning. I am Marie-Céline from beautiful islands of Seychelles. I've got a question for Nick. What about your experiences in the Silicon Valley that can help Africa, to move into that entrepreneurial activities and the attitudes that we need to have, that what can you give us that we can work on?
Thank you for the question. I think it's very important. I think that one thing that I picked up and learned from my trip there was how, and this is no offense to any Americans or anything in the crowd, but
none taken.
Often they err on the side of overstating claims, and South Africans, and I think Africans in general, we understate our claims. We'd rather be conservative about what we've done and what we've achieved and how to market that. I think that is a hindrance in a way for African startups, and that we are quite conservative about our claims. But at the same time, it's something that I am quite proud of personally, that we are quite humble people. But I do think that there's a fine line here between being humble and not being aggressive enough to sell something, and on the other extreme in Silicon Valley, trying to sell nothing because you claim that it's everything.
That's a really, maybe I could, if I could add a little bit to that, because we were actually looking at this with our BioFisa startups. And I mean, one way to think about that is, you know, there's most businesses go through kind of an S curve. There's a long period where you're working hard, but you're not really showing much in terms of revenues or profits or anything like that, then somewhere out there, there's going to be a, it's going to start to scale up, right? So that's kind of the next part of the S, and then it starts to level off eventually. And one trick, I think, is when you're kind of projecting forward what you're going to do is, yes, try to be humble in the beginning. So everybody expects that there's a slow pickup period. So you try to, in a way, underestimate what you can do during that period. But what I've found is a lot of people have a hard time with the you know, predicting this vertical growth and the growth potential. And you have the ability to actually make some predictions there, because that's 3, 4, 5, 6 years in the future. So don't be shy about what the potential there is, because you know, people, investors or early customers, they're making decisions based on this early growth. So I do think that's a dichotomy. But maybe another thing here, you know, I think I find that teams here articulate really a beautiful story. And if you look in Silicon Valley now, most of the startups have what they call chief story officers, or many of them do. So how to build the nice story behind your concept. And what I love about here is that actually it's a continent of storytellers. So always think of the story behind your venture and how to adjust that. Maybe we could, if I'd expand the question, I'm not sure if you guys have spent time in Silicon Valley, but maybe how experiences outside of your own geographic region have affected your ability or kind of learning process as being an entrepreneur. Think of anything there? Well, no. So you don't have any.
I just think that the whole like a startup culture that is really like unfinished.
Yes.
It comes from USA, and that's really, really important to say that it's okay to fail and it's okay to just try, and that has been a big inspiration for me at least.
Yeah.
I think I would say that being particularly a South African startup has massive pros and massive cons in other economic areas. It has enormous pros when we're working with donors and in sort of kind of as part of big projects, because then they see that there's in-country buy-in and they can have an in-country partner, and that's great. Mm-hmm. In the private sector in the US, I don't know if this is just imposter syndrome, but I do feel like we have to work quite a bit harder because of where we come from. I'm not sure. Yeah, I think it's worth saying that.
Yeah, no, I think there's some truth there. There's another nice quote that a lot of people want to become entrepreneurs because they can kind of make their own lifestyle and work when they want to work. And really the flip side of that argument is basically that yes, you can work any 18 hours out of the 24 hours that you want, but you still have to work 18 hours. So and I think that's something that unfortunately probably the U.S. has kind of pushed out. Other questions? Someone else, please. Yep, here in the front first, and then we'll go to the back, and then Ilori, yep.
Morning, everyone. My name's Don. I'm an industrialist, and I'm from Zim. If I heard you correctly, I think the three ventures that presented seemed to convey to me that you were relatively fast in developing your ventures from your idea to through, obviously, prototype, piloting, and commercialization. What we generally hear or understand from reading a lot about entrepreneurship, businesses and that, is that you fail many, many times. That the norm is actually, it's that difficult. And so you have to have the patience to be able to stick with it. And it's many, many years. I mean, we've read lots of examples like, was it Thomas Edison with his light bulb?
Yep.
You kind of fail hundreds of times before you get there. From the presentations, I'm just wondering in my mind, are these three, were you just lucky, fortunate? It seemed fairly quick, unless I got it wrong. You know, and also, in your experiences, your projects may have been relatively quick, but what are your experiences in terms of your colleagues around you? Have they taken a similar amount of time, or have they found it extremely frustrating for theirs, and maybe a bit of envy to say, how can you succeed in such a short period of time? I just wondered about that.
I'm obviously speaking from a more anecdotal point of view. I wasn't there for the genesis of the actual company, but from what I've heard, it was very, very difficult at the beginning, and there was a hell of a lot of these 18-hour days. And the scale-up wasn't very quick. It was quite difficult, but I think that the timing in the product offering that we started off with, which was the umbilical cord blood and tissue stem cells, it was sort of in the middle of the stem cell hype. The timing was perfect, and there wasn't any other competition. I think timing is essential.
Absolutely.
You can sort of bat your head against a wall if the timing's just a little bit out, and then hopefully that timing, the right time, the right place comes along. But these guys will have much better examples.
Yep.
I think there's a saying that says it takes a very long time to be an overnight success.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was thinking. Yep.
And I think that's relevant. So, I mean, I'm not sure if we're sort of 6.5 years from genesis of Notion to where we are now. And I think a lot of that was we had to be very patient, and patience in business is expensive. And I think we were extremely lucky in terms of, in the early days, we had an enormous amount of support from the university and enormous amount of support from the technology transfer office. And they kind of held our hands and got us through the part of a business where you're trying to figure out how to make relationships. And also got us through when I think that often academics are having problems in their labs that industry are going to have in about 10 years' time. And we found now that commercially people are starting to ask exactly the same questions of us that academics were asking of us in 2011, 2012. And so now suddenly we're starting to see so much interest sort of ramp up. But there was a fair bit of slaving away in the dark before that. So I think it's, slowly and then quickly is how it happens, I think.
And then that lightning strikes at some point, and it appears that it's an overnight success, but it's you've been positioning for that for a long time. What after?
Yes, that's right. That we at least have been fast, and we have been fortunate. I think we were fortunate to find the solution for the product quite quickly. But of course, we can't forget that I had like 15 years experience about oats, and then there was lots of experience of beans. So it was quite structured work what we could make. So we were like experienced researchers, and we knew how to go and how to try to test the next things. And we have been doing lots of work as well. But still, I think we have been fortunate because there was the time.
Yeah.
We were in the exactly right time, and that you never know if the trend is there or not. But when we were publishing our first product, not in sales, but only like a testing, and publishing in social media, it really
resonated with the audience. Yeah.
Everyone understood what we wanted to say. And we were first in the category, so we were actually creating the whole category to Finland. So that is something that you can't like plan of doing in such a short time. So it's something that you need luck.
But in a sense, you were able to put a team together that was ready to pick up on that in a really when the opportunity appeared.
Yeah. Because there was so much demand from the retailers and consumers. So that it was quite easy to find funding and team and so on. So everything was much easier when there was the demand. And that was where we were fortunate. But to be fast, I think that when you publish your food product, I don't know about other products, but it's also our IP strategy to be as fast as possible. And that has been our trademark. So we have been like doing, I don't know, how long it usually takes to build up processes, but it takes from us like half a year, not more.
Maybe one other insight from your team is Reta's co-entrepreneur is an experienced entrepreneur. It actually had a very successful company in the IT space So when you guys joined up, there was already this feeling there was a dream team of science and then kind of execution on the startup side. Yeah, Kilona, I guess, and then Hillary.
Okay, great. Thanks very much. I'd be very I look after a university spin-off, and I'd be very interested to understand the support system that you received from the University Tech Transfer Office, and I think that question is for Hyrex Biosciences. Yep. And you mentioned specific, and you mentioned support, you know, hand-holding in your early days. It'd be interesting for me to understand the precise kinds of areas that they assisted you in, and how we could possibly leverage the success that you have achieved in our environment.
That's a great question. This is one of my favorite topics.
Let's start.
So I think in the beginning to realize academic researchers, we didn't know what we didn't know. We really didn't. We thought business was this kind of amorphous concept. So in the beginning, they helped us with understanding how to even hire business people, basic contracting, like taking us really, really by the hand and through the process of what it means to be business people. And I'm actually still the scientist in this whole adventure. I've got a T and not an E. But my PhD supervisor is now the CEO of the company and is loving the business side of things and is really, really, really caught his imagination. And I think it was amazing to watch the University of Western Cape just like invest in that journey. And yeah, still to this day.
Do you want to add anybody want to add anything to that? I mean, one thing again that strikes me relating back to Silicon Valley, one of the really interesting things there is the level of respect between the research community and the business community. And I think that was one big takeaway when I ran a program where we sent a number of scientists from Finland to Stanford to just breathe the air for 2 weeks, and what they all came back with was the fact that the scientists were excited to interact with the business people, and then vice versa. And so I think that's kind of the mutual respect area is something. So bringing in the mentorship, so the scientists that are kind of mature enough to realize they need to bring in business mentorship around. But good question. Yep, Hillary.
Yes, thank you. Very interesting stories, all of you, and I think my question was really related to the two previous questions. It's more about reflecting that, especially both Red and Imogen, you come from quite well-established environments or ecosystems where there's a lot of support available, and obviously one step forward is the Silicon Valley type of environment. And clearly you've been successful also partly because that kind of support mechanism and culture has established itself. But do you think you would have been successful if you would have started in a little bit less established ecosystem in your countries?
That's a good question.
Is it? It's a difficult question. I don't know if I can answer the question because I'm living in the world where I'm living. So what I can say is that because we didn't make the innovation at university, so I don't know about the university support systems so much. But what we saw in the beginning was that we really need advisors, and we had really five really nice advisors, and that was the everything. To get all the all the network and all the information that we needed, and so we were able to be fast because of these really experienced ones. But yeah, possibly you can answer better.
I almost just want to say no and stop there, but I'm gonna up that to maybe. I think that. You know, it takes a village, and I think building those villages is a massive part of the work that we need to do. I think this kind of mythology of the solo entrepreneur who strikes out on her own and does the thing is a very rare story. I think without the support that we needed to get the funding that we needed to get the support that we needed to, you know, there's always a moment when you've got to bootstrap, and particularly in biotech where there are costs and there's time and there are big Leviathan corporate companies to deal with, trying to go it alone, it would have been extremely difficult. Yeah.
So one thing that strikes me is you're obviously two women, and I guess the founder of NextBio was also a woman. So I think it's a rarity to have three successful entrepreneurs, women entrepreneurs, just almost by accident. Normally, normally a panel like this, three women founded startups, would be about women founded startups, right? And now it's just about successful startups. So I think that's fantastic. But maybe a little bit of a question about the gender issues. I mean, did you feel any special challenges or otherwise based on being women? And maybe you could answer from Kim's perspective. Do you want to
start? Our company is about 80% women now. So
you're the token male?
Precisely, yeah. When I arrived at the beginning of 2016, there was only one other guy, and he left, and then I was the only guy, and then luckily we've got a couple more. But you bring up a valuable point that I think we're going to be seeing more and more of this, and I think it's a wonderful area that science is moving into. You know, I mean, previously it has been dominated by men, and it's not the way it is anymore, clearly, which is a wonderful thing.
Yeah.
It's always a difficult question, sort of. I think being a woman in kind of science in general, there are always going to be difficulties. It's always been something that I've been quite aware of, and I think it's important to be honest that there are times when I felt like I've had to shout a little bit louder to get my voice heard. There are also enormous pros in that now I think even for software development jobs, half of our blind applicants are women. And that I think having a female CTO really helps other women then come into the company. I don't know if that is an experience that maybe is familiar. We know that does help companies succeed. So that's a great success. Yeah, it's a tough one.
Yep.
Yes, I will echo you. I mean, it's being a technologist, I think that has been the biggest challenge, because scientists in Finland and Scandinavia, most of the scientists are women. But when going to a little bit more technical side, there is no women anymore.
Yep.
And I have not been. I was actually the first woman, the CTO of the year, and I was the first woman in this category. So in Finland, so
wow.
I have been possibly
That's
making
right.
something.
Yeah. That was 2016, right?
Yeah, last year was it? Yes, but. I've been too busy to think about that. Of course, in some cases, I understand that people are trying to hint something, but it doesn't matter so much.
But maybe one thing, knowing your founding team was basically you, Maya, and the Chinese, what's his name again?
Chong Xing.
So it was a Chinese man, right? So it was in a way you had some diversity on the founding team, which I found to be pretty interesting. But maybe, I don't know, any cultural issues related maybe to having a Chinese co-founder?
Yeah, we have been working or collaborating a lot with Chinese machinery companies, and that has been interesting that they have been really appreciating our knowledge and our professionalship. So I have not noticed any. I was waiting for some that, hey, are two girls coming here, but no. It was only when we were trying to get this first like government money. That was the only place where we were girls.
Yes. Okay. Great. Other questions? Oh yes.
Hi, guys. My name is Luazi. Thank you for the talk. Just one question. How do you attract the necessary technical skills with minimum resources in your initial stages? And
good question. So what tricks did you do to get the resources in early? Yep.
It really depends, of course, what you're doing. But if thinking about what we have been doing, I think it was really necessary to have the first employee that was 100% and that I could lead and have like the bigger picture and not being on the laboratory all the time. So that wouldn't work, to be on the floor and trying to understand where we are going. So you need, from the very beginning, few employees who can really do the work.
Mm-hmm. I think that employees will come to companies that they feel like will care about them and give them a good quality of life, and also are paying them as much as they can, not as little as they can.
Yes.
I think it's important to try and rectify the situation where startups often spectacularly underpay their employees.
Yes.
But I think that we offer remote work 2 days a week. We give people leave. We make sure that their families see them sometimes. And those kinds of things are often significantly more important to people than their salaries at the end of the day. And I think offering that kind of balance is how you get the really good people who are also then going to really buy into the vision and really care about the customers at the end of the day, because they're the people who care about people. And that's who you want.
Great, great point. Nick?
I think that going sort of more directly to your question about not maybe having the resources to be able to pay people very large salaries, for me personally, the idea of ownership, if at an early stage I was offered some small, even if it was a token bit of ownership of in equity for the company, that would mean a hell of a lot, because all of a sudden you're working for something that's yours, which I think would attract the right type of talent without the resources. If you're not able to pay them as much as they're worth.
Good points. Okay, maybe, so I think we're getting close to the end here, so maybe the final question is if each of you could give your best piece of advice to an aspiring scientist who is interested to become an entrepreneur. Start with Radha.
Oh. You can start.
Okay, well, we could start with Imogen.
I'll still need a second.
It was on the list, so it's fair.
So I don't really have a qualified view on this. I'm not in the same league as these two women. But I think that it comes with a sort of cultural change. So I would say that from early on in an advanced degree, a PhD or a master's, to start thinking about business and start thinking about ways that you can commercialize your research, and trying to change that mindset early on, I think is very valuable. And if I could go back, I would certainly do my advanced degrees with a more entrepreneurial mindset to begin with.
That's a good comment.
Yeah, that's a very good point. I think I'd add, starting a company is, even thinking about starting a company, even starting to build a product that you might want to start a company around, is stressful and requires a massive leap of faith. And I think that what saved me from, I guess, a nervous breakdown during the very stressful parts is getting up every day and just doing what I can to make it work for that day. Like if you have the right principles and you keep the vision in mind and then think, okay, what can I do today to get a little bit closer to that mountain, everything else starts to follow.
Yep. I would say that find a partner, don't do it yourself by yourself, because it's very important when you get really tired and frustrated, there needs to be someone who really is in the same situation. And try to find someone not from your area, because that's making the really making the discussion that is needed, that you can make the great product.
Great. Okay. So maybe I'll finish off with just the I think Imogen made the two great messages of humility and courage, and I think you all have shown some of that here. So thank you for that. So it's really authentic. Thanks to the audience for spending time with us. And let's go have some lunch. Thanks.